If you would like to support the channel, then please turn off adblock and refresh the page. Alternatively, use the link in the description below to donate to T1 Patreon. Thank you. Hello Magic Community on YouTube, I'm T1 Glistener Elf. Really quickly, I have another deck tech for you. This is one that I've seen recently on MTG Top 8, well, something similar to it anyway, and I wanted to show it off because of how creative it is. This is a legacy deck called 4-Color Leovold Control. Leovold as in Emissary of Trest, who we'll get to in just a second. We'll start off the deck list with 4 Deathrite Shaman. Do I really need to say much about this card? Do I need to sing its praises? It's a 1-mana 1/2. It could be green or black and it's still a ramp card. Gets rid of lands from the graveyard. It can exile their creatures. It can gain you life. It can make them lose life. It's a Swiss Army knife. It's a 1-mana Planeswalker. Do I really need to say anything else? It's good. Just take my word for it. And next we have one of the most underrated 2-for-1s in Legacy, I believe. Baleful Strix. I say 2-for-1. Obviously it draws you a card right then, but it's also a flying Death Touch creature. So it will either take one of their removal spells, say a Bolt or a Swords to Plowshares, or it'll just trade with something, say an Insect Aberration. This is a good card. This is an underrated card. Admittedly, it is slow, and while it is great on value, it doesn't really advance your game plan, so I imagine that that's part of why it doesn't see more play. However, in a similar fashion, we have True-Name Nemesis, another awesomely good card in the fair matches. Enters the battlefield, choose a player. It has protection from the chosen player, so it can't be blocked, targeted, dealt damage, or enchanted, or equipped by anything controlled by that player. Anything. This is your baby progenitus, I suppose. This is Etch Champion for Merfolk, or just anything, actually. Needless to say, this is a good card. Also, look at that power. This might be playable as a 1-1. As a 3-1, it is definitely, definitely playable. Super good. Alright, but then we get to Big Daddy himself, Leovold, the Emissary of Trest. So each opponent can draw more than one card each turn. So, of course, Brainstorm, do not cast it. Ponder becomes Index for 3 with the option to shuffle. And then whenever you or permanent you control becomes the target of a spell or ability an opponent controls, you may draw a card. So if they waste them one of your lands, draw a card. If they try to deal with Leovold with spot removal, draw a card. If they try to take out one of your other creatures, draw a card. If they try to bolt your face, draw a card. You get the idea. This is a good, good card. The mana cost is a little tricky sometimes. This is a 4-color deck after all, but it is a 3-3 and it wears that proudly. And what can I say? It's an elf. It's really good. Now for this next one, it's just a 1-of, but there are a few cards that this could be. I've bounced back and forth, and this is what I've settled on for now. I have a 1-of Tombstalker in the list. So it's 6 in black-black, but you aren't casting it for nearly that. Flying and Delve. So often this ends up being, as it was in Future Sight for the longest time if you played that block or standard, a 2-mana 5/5 flyer. Future Sight, or Time Plural block was weird, right? You had, as big creatures there, a 5/5 flyer for 2, and a 5/6 for 2. In any case, other options include Gurmog Angler, which gives you the option to just pay black instead of black-black, but you lose flying, and Tassiger, which requires one less card to be in the graveyard to cast it, and it has an extra nifty little ability, but for one thing, it's only a 4/5, and for another, it's legendary, so it loses to Caracas. I think that Tombstalker is fine for this deck. I'm sometimes worried about the mana cost being a bit harsh, but with as much counter magic as we have, including free counter magic, I think that we can get away with paying 2 mana for him. I think. I imagine so, anyway. And the fact that it flies means that it gets over other true names, and it wears some equipment we have in this deck proudly. For our last win condition card, I suppose, we have Big Daddy Jace the Wallet Sculptor himself. Can't go wrong with Scry or Fate Seal, Brainstorm, Unsummon, and You Win the Game. Those are the modes on this thing. This is such a good card. I know I don't need to sing Jace's praises. It was banned in Standard, and then banned in Modern. It was on the original Modern ban list, for those that didn't know. Deservedly so. So now let's get into our, let's just say, blue category. Our blue non-creatures. We have four Brainstorm, because that's what you do. Sorry that I have to run this as a one of. I only have three of these. I think this is the best Brainstorm art, personally. For whatever that's worth. I mean, look at that. So this is often just Ancestral Recall. Again, I'm not sure that I need to sing its praises. It's one of the hardest cards to play in Eternal Magic. I would imagine, to me, it's either number one or two for most skill-oriented card, the other being Cabal Therapy, maybe. Next we have Ponder or Contemplation. Okay, cool. Just, again, with fetch lands, like with Brainstorm, this goes from being, okay, to this is restricted in Vintage. This is a good card, too. Alright. I don't need to say too much about that, I imagine. We'll put the French one on top, though. Why not? Next, we have four Force of Will. So with this many blue cards, we can afford to, we can get away with it. And we aren't a very fast deck. We fight the unfair decks. We certainly need to, actually. Sort of speaks for itself beyond that, I suppose. On that note, we have a little bit more counter magic, free counter magic. We have two copies of Daze. Four spike for free. Just four spike for free. Return an island you control to its owner's hand to free cast it. All but one of our... Well, that's wrong. We have Fetchlands, Wastelands, and one non-island. But that's it. And then lastly, we run a one-up Spell Pierce. I think that we could run, say, another Daze, but I want to be able to counter artifacts, enchantments, and planeswalkers, too, a little bit more readily later on in the game. It becomes easy enough, for them to just pay one. They can do that pretty often. Not with Spell Pierce. Alright, now, for our non-blue interaction, Thoughtseize. We're going to start off with two Thoughtseize. Just tear our opponent's hand apart. Again, we need something to shore up the unfair matches, the combo matches, and stripping their best card out of their hand is often where we want to be. Next, we have four Abrupt Decays. This is largely for miracles, for counterbalance, but of course the applications are endless. There are very few decks where Abrupt Decay won't do something. Notably, of course, decks like Storm, where I guess you can make them pop a Lotus Petal early, and that's really about it. That's not much. But it's a necessary evil. This helps us to fight Delver, fight miracles, those sorts of things. And a few hate cards that might shut us out of the game otherwise. Next, we have Sudden Shock. This card is sometimes, and I'm not kidding, better than Lightning Bolt in Modern. For a number of reasons, what comes to mind first is Death and Taxes. This will hit Mother of Runes before she can protect their other creatures. This also hits Glistener Elf and creatures in Delver. Of course, in Rogue Delver, it's basically just Delver. Tarmogoyf is often too big. And Nimble Mongoose has Shroud, but you get the idea. The card Delver of Secrets, and of course, others, Stoneforge Mystic. Yeah. This is a card that you would pay an extra mana for Shock just to have it not be counterable. That's how powerful that effect is in Legacy. I apologize if you hear my voice start to go. I've been doing a number of these today. Next we have a one of Kolaghan's Command. So, all of the modes are potentially useful. You haven't seen it yet, but we do have an artifact, but that's a... We're not destroying our artifact, my apologies. Return target creature, plenty of creatures. Make them discard a card at instant speed. If they're hellbent, this can sort of feel like a Vendilion click a little bit. Wait for them to draw the card and then make them get rid of it. destroy an artifact, or shock, just an extra shock effect. It's usually a 2-for-1. Usually. You can find some way to make it work. Next we have Umezawa's Jitte. Just as a 1-of, no Stoneforge Mystic to go and find it, but with this much draw power, I think that we can afford to have one. If you can resolve this, this makes certain matches like Elves and Infect much easier. Or much less difficult, I suppose. And plenty of other decks as well. Jitte can just get out of control. If Deathrite Shaman is a Planeswalker for 1 mana, then Umezawa's Jitte is a Planeswalker for 2. Now we get on to the lands. So we're going to start off with the duels. We run 3 Underground Seas, because these are the 2 most important colors in the deck, of course. We run 3 Tropical Islands. We run a fair amount of green, as you've seen. Between Deathrite Shaman's ability and Abrupt Decay and Leovold, we do rather need it. Next we have a couple copies of Volcanic Island for the red that we have in here, Sudden Shock and Kolaghan's Command, as well as some sideboard cards we've yet to get to just yet. And we also have a 1-of Badlands. This is the one that can't be found off of a blue fetch. However, I think that there are enough cases when this is necessary that we just keep it as a 1-of. That's all, just a 1-of. It does make the Daze a little bit worse, which is part of why I'm only running 2. Now, that being the case, with this particular combination of dual lands, the only fetch lands that will get all of them are Polluted Delta and Scalding Tarn. So we run 4 of each. Easy enough, right? I think so. And then lastly, and of course, no fewer than 8 fetches because you have Brainstorms and Ponders. Lastly, we have Wasteland. 3 Wastelands. Now, admittedly, they don't cast as much in this deck as we would like. They don't cast Deathrite Shaman, or Baleful Strix, or Leovold. Hopefully you get to the stage in the game where they aren't casting Tombstalker, although they fill the graveyard for Tombstalker. But nevertheless, I think that they're necessary because of plenty of matches where you can just get some free wins by taking out their lands. And beyond even that, I think that we have enough colorless in here. Fight the decks that run few lands and are mostly or all non-basics like Delver, and you still have the interaction to deal with their threats. If you can deal with their lands and their threats, well then you have those games unlocked. And now for the sideboard. We'll start off with, I hate burn. No, in all seriousness, this is chill. Red spells cost an additional 2 mana to play. It puts you so far ahead of, say, burn, that they can't win. This can also be used against Imperial Painter, where it hits their Rebs, their Pyroblast, their Blood Moons, if you happen to not be under one already, etc. Next we have good old Dread of Night. White creatures get -1/-1. Bring this in against Death and Taxes. This card has actually gotten a lot better since Recruiter of the Guard came out, because also known as Demonic Tutor. Recruiter of the Guard goes and gets creatures with toughness 2 or less. And of course, 1 is less than 2. They can go and get their Moms, they can go and get their Thalias, they can go and get their Spirit of the Labyrinth, they can go and get Flicker Wisp, they can get whatever they need to. If they go and get one that has 1 toughness, well, you've just shut down a fair portion of their deck. Next, for the Storm matches, we have 2 Fluster Storms, although I'm strongly considering replacing 1 of these with a Mindbreak Trap. In any case, these are just the counter spells that can't be countered, or at least they seem like it a lot of the time. They're awfully good. Next we have Invasive Surgery. So, whereas Fluster Storm only hits instants and sorceries, this only hits sorceries. It's your envelop now. But with Delirium, if you happen to have that on, then you can make them exile from their graveyard, hand, and library all spells with the same name. Okay, so there are a few matches where this is just a blowout. The one that jumps out most to me is Sneak and Show. If you can hit their Show and Tell with this, ooh, you are in hot shape. You reduce them to just Sneak Attack. Alright. Which, of course, they can win from, But you can make that pretty hard too. If you only have to counter sneak attack, you're more likely to be able to win the ultimate counter wars. Next we have Is It Staticaster for, again, decks with lots of one toughness. As an Infect main, I may be over-prioritizing that match, but it's important. But beyond that, we also, of course, have Elves, we have Death and Taxes. Those are the ones that jump out most to me. I imagine that you could also use it against, I guess, the Empty the Warrens decks, like Charbelcher, but it seems a little bit slow. But they all have the same name. Hit every single one of those tokens. And you get the idea, so other decks that fight on that axis. Next we have a one of Liliana of the Veil, which almost makes the main board, I think. She does work. When she does work, she does work. The plus can be used to fight combo decks by stripping resources out of their hand, while you already hopefully have an established board if you're at this stage in the game. The Edict, of course, just takes out their creatures, including opposing True-Name Nemesis, and then the minus six is just a nice little ult, a nice little value edict. Yeah. What can I say? She speaks for herself like Jace the Mind Sculptor does. I don't know if this is still true, but for the longest time, she was seeing more play in Legacy than Jace. Or at least she was seeing more copies than Jace. Decks might run two Jaces, they could run... they could run more Lilies. Next we have Casualties. Now, I would like to run Toxic Deluge, but we have too many creatures for that. And so what are we running instead? Something that makes it where only the creatures our opponent controls gets minus one, minus one. Now, it's tough. I really want to run something like Knight of Soul's Betrayal, but Baleful Strix and True Name Nemesis are cards, and they're eight together, so I can't do that. Instead, two mana, minus one to their creatures with the potential to make it minus two if you pay five mana. And it's a sorcery. Okay, it's not great, but for some matches, you need it, frankly. Next we have Nile Spellbomb. Good old graveyard hate that also draws you a card. If I ever take out a casualty, I'm taking another Nile Spellbomb and sticking it straight in. Gives you game against the Dredge decks, Reanimator, etc., while also just keeping you drawing more cards. Next we have Red Elemental Blast to help out with the counter wars. They're probably not bringing in their Blue Elemental Blast or their Hydro Blast against you after all. Can't have that old Ice Age or Alpha counter war. Next we have Submerge. Okay, so you will control an island. If they also control a forest, you can just spin a creature, put it on top of their deck. Good against Delver, good against Infect, good against even, say, if you're familiar with Shardless Bug or Bug Delver, then yeah, you can play it against those. Also, Maverick, I believe, this plays well with. I'm not entirely sure of that, but I think I would side it in against Maverick, if that's a part of your meta. And then lastly, we have the other two Thoughtseizes for the combo decks. You know, when you don't have enough already in the two in the main and your counter spells, it's nice to just be able to have all of the answers to strip them constantly, turn after turn, or to just keep them from being able to resolve anything. I very much like that slow value grind style of control, which this deck, as you can see, does awfully well. Baleful Strix, Deathrite Shaman, Leovold, these are cards that do especially well on that front. We have four Brainstorms and a Jace for that sort of value. Plenty of card draw, plenty of counterspells, including free counterspells. I will admit, though, one concern that I have with the deck is that Daze seems like it would not be... It seems like it doesn't stay live for very long in the game. Partially because I'm trying to get up to three mana as quickly as I can, and partially because I can't defeat the opponent quickly enough to make a Daze four spike forever. Even with three wastelands, I don't think we get there. Part of the reason why that's so good in Delver is because they're trying to keep you off of all of your resources with cards like Wasteland and Stifle, and so Daze is live for longer in the game.
You can run Daze and Infect because you're killing the opponent, hopefully, awfully quickly, and if the game never gets past the first few turns, well, you don't really care. But in a deck like this, I might be too slow to run Daze, and this is one way that I differ from the list that I saw on MTG Top 8. I'm actually skeptical about that. I might include more spell pierces. That's what I'm leaning towards, at least. Or I could go for Flusterstorms in the main as well, like two spell pierce and a Flusterstorm. I'd be alright with that. It would answer my dilemma about having two Flusterstorms in the side. I could go to one in a Mindbreak Trap. Easy enough, right? Alright, that's it for now. Take care, Magic community. I will see you later. I hope you've enjoyed these deck techs. I promise I'll have more to come, despite my my financial situation. You can look forward to those. And I'll see you later. If you have any comments or suggestions, feel free to throw them down below, and I'll happily read them. And if I see anything significant enough, I might redo this deck tech and add your suggestion in. So, good night.